once again underway at Cape Canaveral, the attempt to launch astronaut John Glenn into orbit around the world.
Reporting to the British Broadcasting Corporation in London. The zero hour, the Colonel Glenn's launch...
...général en Floride, où une fois de plus, les dernières minutes de départ de l'astronaute américain...
...stato contati minuti per l'astronauta americano John Glenn al Cape Canaveral, Florida.
يتحضر مرة ثانية لدورته حول العالم.
فلوريداجو كان فاكو تايكون خانشنان يوهان غيلين
كيب كنابرالدا أمريكان وجوهيكوشي جون غلين نصوكيو مكزيني
جيكتو ميركوريو han reportado que ambos, el astronauta y su cohete Friendship 7
and report the astronaut's condition as excellent.
Colonel Glenn at Cape Canaveral. And then astronaut Glenn, whether still remains the big question mark. But the countdown for Colonel
John Glenn, the countdown is again underway.
The entire world is our witness. The countdown begins at Cape Canaveral, Florida, for one of man's greatest adventures. It begins here with these men, for they are the launch team. And from now until the instant of flight, the fate of today's mission rests principally upon their skills and judgments. The countdown is their master plan, and they proceed through its ritual with unhurried deliberation. Its pages contain the timetable of order they must follow to awaken a giant machine, to test its readiness, and to prime it for the one supreme moment for which it was created.
ISO on now, meter reads 19 volts. 12 volt standby on, now meter reads 11.5. 6 volt isolated on.
Minute after minute, page upon page, the count continues. And in the night beyond this blockhouse, a modified Air Force Atlas rocket now hums with restless energy beneath a Mercury spacecraft as these men usher it toward its final minutes on Earth. Today is February 20th, 1962. And today, if all goes well, the men here will launch an American astronaut into orbit around the world in a spacecraft which he has named Friendship 7. Friendship 7 awaits its pilot. And the pilot has waited 3 years for this day. 3 long, arduous years of study, of training, of waiting. And now he's ready. His name is John Glenn. Astronaut John Glenn of New Concord, Ohio. Lieutenant Colonel, United States Marine Corps. Married, father of 2 teenage children. Glenn has been a pilot over half of his 40 years. Has flown in 2 wars. And is a veteran test pilot who 5 years earlier established a transcontinental flight record as the first man to average supersonic speeds across America. He volunteered for spaceflight, is one of 7 astronauts selected for Project Mercury, the man in space program directed by the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Two teammates have pioneered the way into space for Glenn. Astronauts Alan Shepard and Virgil Grissom tested the Mercury spacecraft on trailblazing suborbital missions, proving moving the equipment and pushing the program to the threshold of orbital flight. And now, it's Glenn's turn.
Ready for pressurization?
Now to Glenn falls the challenge of man's next advance into space, for he has been chosen to cross the threshold gained by Shepard and Grissom and to orbit the world. So the countdown continues for John Glenn. And it continues beyond this room for Friendship 7. And it continues this moment around the world. These are John Glenn's ground-based co-pilots, men he knows well, with whom he's trained, and in whose judgment his life is entrusted this day. They are the flight controllers, and from the Mercury Control Center, within view of the launch complex, they make the decisions, issue the commands that will govern the course of the mission. To these men, throughout the flight, will flood the facts needed for decision. The scope of their responsibility of the entire operation defies comprehension. Now, this very instant, the countdown for flight continues around the world, on three continents, on islands, in ships and planes, in lands where it's summer and tomorrow is near, in lands where it's winter, and this day is just beginning.
Roger, how about you recovering?
Recovery.
Roger, CTC, Mercury Control Center is go.
Northeast of Cape Canaveral, 1,000 miles into the Atlantic, dawn's early light spills over the British Crown Colony of Bermuda, and Station 2 in the Mercury network proceeds with the countdown. The tracking and telemetry stations, 18 in all, form an avenue of electronic checkpoints around the world to monitor and communicate with Friendship 7 as it passes overhead.
Okay, this is Bermuda. Okay, this is Bermuda.
Roger. Telemetry, M&O.
If radar is the eyes of the station, then telemetry is the ears. Each second, telemetry will hear and record nearly 2,000 items of information radioed down from Friendship 7. And in the months to come, engineers and scientists will find in telemetry records the answers needed for the bolder space explorations of the future.
Displays and recorders have been calibrated. Roger, thank you. Flight, this is M&O.
Go ahead, M&O.
All subsystems status green.
Roger, M&O. Understand all systems green.
Latitude, 5 degrees north. Longitude, 10 degrees west. A spot in the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of Africa. And Station 3, the Rose Knot, waits under the late morning sun for John Glenn. Operating out of Trinidad, Rose Knot will communicate with Friendship 7 and monitor its journey as it streaks across the empty ocean and out over Africa.
Operation, this is Bridge. We're proceeding at slow speed at about 5 knots. The course is 198 through, over.
Beyond the Mercury station on Gran Canary Island, in the Spanish archipelago off of the African coast, it's midday at Station 5 in Kano, Nigeria, deep in the continent of Africa.
All stations.
Flight data recorded here at Kano and at Zanzibar on Africa's east coast will relay through this transmitting station to London and then on to America. To the southeast of Kano, beyond the Zanzibar station, the ship's bell of the coastal sentry tolls the twilight of day in the emptiness of the Indian Ocean. To the east, some 2,500 miles from the coastal sentry, dust blankets the network 8 station at Mushe, near Perth, Western Australia. Halfway around the world, okay. From Cape Canaveral.
And the printout, card display. Okay, that's fine. Just tweak it up on here.
Today, February 20th, is fast fading over the Australian tracking sites at Mushe and Woomera. And when Glenn arrives, tomorrow we'll greet him. But north and east across the Pacific, far beyond the Mercury station on the coral atoll called Canton Island, February 20th is just minutes old on Hawaii's garden island of Kauai, and there men prepare for the arrival of Friendship 7.
Locked on board side and ready for a 165 check.
All right,
Roger.
If that bitter is good.
All right,
Roger. Eastward again, deeper into the day that will soon awaken over the Americas. Eastward to the Gulf of California, and to the Mercury station at Guaymas, Mexico.
Real good, just waiting for liftoff. MNOTM, status green, proceeding with pre-pass calibrations.
North of Mexico, in the pre-dawn along the west coast of the United States, the mountaintop station at Point Arguello, California, waits out the long countdown, ready to track John Glenn.
Roger, Rack 8. What is the present count? Roger.
Southeast now, to the farmlands of Texas, where the station at Corpus Christi continues its preparations for flight.
Guaymas, Calvin, Texas, please.
Affirmative.
Roger, all systems, would you please commence pre-flight calibrations at this time since the countdown is progressing normally? Advise me when you have completed them.
Far to the north and east of Corpus Christi beats the heart of the worldwide Mercury network, the computing and communication center that bonds it into a working entity. This is the Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. Through here funnels the voice and teletype communications that link the global stations to Mercury control. The computers enable men to reach judgments within the flashes of time allowed for control of a spacecraft that moves faster than a brain can react. Throughout the flight, the computers will generate recommendations on whether the mission should continue or be aborted. They will determine locations of the spacecraft, the time it should begin re-entry, the point at which it will land. And the most vital of these findings will be transmitted instantaneously to Cape Canaveral. Around the world, all is ready. The men, the stations, the space vehicle. And now reporters learn from the astronaut's information officer if the most vital of all elements is ready, the man himself, John Glenn.
Thank you.
rocket into history. Glenn is the astronaut, the man who will challenge space. But he is just one member of an international scientific endeavor that requires the genius and skills of some 40,000 other men and women scattered throughout the world. From the engineers and technicians who produce the space vehicle, to the crews now preparing to launch it. From the tracking experts who will chart his voyage around the globe, to the sailors now waiting at sea to recover him. Behind this day stands years of preparation, of research and testing, of planning and training. And the purpose of it all is knowledge. Knowledge of space and of how effectively man and spacecraft can function together in its hostile environment. Knowledge that will serve as the basis for space explorations of the future. Hard-won knowledge of benefit to all men. Bought by sacrifice and dedication and courage. Now, just a handful of minutes remain until the spacecraft crew on the service tower call for the pilot of Friendship 7.
Okay, all set. Yeah, all set.
end of John Glenn's life. His heartbeat, you hear, will flow from Friendship 7 throughout the flight, informing those on the ground how well he endures the trials ahead. Into the soft light of this Florida dawn emerges Friendship 7, making its debut to the day of its destiny. The Mercury Atlas stands alone, waiting to depart this Earth. A quarter of a million pounds of rocket, with thrust equal to 3.5 million horsepower. All to hurdle a 168-pound astronaut into space.
All stations. Gantry is in launch position. AMR, CNS band beacons are on. Start interrogation in 1 minute.
The countdown sweeps closer to the moment of flight, and recovery teams here at the Cape and around the world ready themselves to aid the astronaut. Above all else, John Glenn's safety is paramount, the dictating factor in all planning. Never in all of history have so many people shared, without censorship, an adventure of such magnitude. Through all news media in all languages, all the peoples of the world are witness to this exploration of space, to its success or failure. Indicator in the capsule will begin showing John Glenn his changing positions above the world.
High level light.
You are go. Order systems.
Go.
Range operations.
cleared and launcher.
Mercury capsule, go. All pre-start panel lights are correct. The ready light is on. Eject Mercury umbilical. Oil evacuate.
Mercury umbilical clear.
Mercury
evacuate, lights on.
All recorders too fast. T-minus 18 seconds and counting engine start.
You may the wee ones be with you, Thomas.
Good Lord, ride all the way.
Give Godspeed, John Glenn. 10, 9, 8, 7.
Engine will shut down. When Friendship 7 should separate from the booster rocket and begin orbital flight.
Seiko! Five grades fired, okay. Roger, 0G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous.
To John Glenn, now belongs an awesome panorama. The world curving beneath him, just as it was filmed from an earlier Mercury capsule.
And I could see the booster during turnaround just a couple of hundred yards behind me. It was beautiful.
You have a go, at least 7 orbits.
Roger, understand go for at least 7 orbits.
The Friendship 7, I can see clear back a big cloud pattern way back across toward the Cape. Beautiful sight.
is everything okay? All systems okay? Good voice contact both ways.
Roger. Friendship 7, anything to report on control system checks?
Not yet. Everything appears to be going okay. I'm now on the yaw part of the check. We are right on schedule.
Very good, very good.
So far is excellent. Very good. No problems at all so far on control.
Roger. Friendship 7, it's Bermuda. You're cutting out on UHF. If you read, go to HF.
Roger, going.
Friendship 7, Bermuda Capcom on HF. Friendship 7, Friendship 7. Friendship 7, I read you very weak. Give me your status on control system check, please.
Friendship 7, Friendship 7, clear Capcom. Read you. Friendship 7, horizon is a brilliant blue. Greenland in sight at present time, coming up on the scope. We have beautiful view of the African coast, both in the scope and out the window. Out the window is by far the best view. Part of the Canaries was hit by clouds.
I can see dust storms down there blowing across the desert. A lot of dust. It's difficult to see the ground in some areas. Over.
Friendship 7, Friendship 7, you're fading. Now be over.
Friendship 7, this is Kano Capcom. I read you loud and clear. How do you read me? Over.
Roger, Kano, loud and clear.
Roger, loud and clear. What is your status? Over.
So this is Friendship 7. My status is excellent. I feel fine. Over.
Roger, I monitored part of your transmission over Canary and heard your comments on the weather over Africa. We've had dusty weather here, and as far as we can see, a lot of this part of Africa is covered with dust.
That's exactly the way it looks from up here, too.
Roger, will you give us a status report? Over.
Roger, this is Friendship 7, fuel 9098, oxygen 78100, cabin pressure holding 5.6 at present time. And preparing to take silo still at present time.
Roger, do you want to stand by for retro sequence time, Area 1, Charlie?
Roger, going back on ASCS, yaw check, okay. It's a little different display than I had really anticipated, but it checks okay, and I can pick up yaw. I have to be about 5.
Friendship 7, you are fading rapidly.
Across Africa races Friendship 7 at 17,545 miles an hour, 300 miles a minute, 4 miles for every heartbeat of John Glenn. Friendship 7 streaks through the night of tomorrow and races toward the dawn of yesterday. Above the Indian Ocean flashes Friendship 7, far beyond human sight, seen only by the electronic instruments of the Coastal Sentry as she records the lightning passage of the man in space. John Glenn, the familiar time references of Earth no longer apply, for he journeys around our world in just 88 minutes, outracing the sun that needs 24 hours to circle the same globe.
Friendship 7, Friendship 7, this is Bouchet, com tape. Friendship 7, this is Bouchet Comtech. Do read, over.
Hello, Bouchet Comtech. This is Friendship 7, reading you loud and clear. How many?
Roger, Friendship 7, Bouchet Capcom. How many, over?
Roger, how you doing, Gordo? We're doing real fine up here. Everything is going very well, over.
Very good, John. You sound good.
Roger. That was sure a short day.
Time passes rapidly, huh?
Yes, sir.
Shortly, you may observe some lights down there. You want to take a check on them out to your right, over.
Roger, I'm all set to see if I can't get them in sight.
Roger. Any symptoms of vertigo or nausea at all, over?
Negative, no symptoms whatsoever. I feel fine, over.
Good show.
Roger, I do have a light's in sight on the ground, over.
Roger, I understand there. Just off to your right there?
That's affirmative. Just to my right, I can see a big pattern of light. Apparently right on the coast. I can see the outline of a town and a very bright light just to the south of it.
Roger, that's Perth and Rockingham you're seeing there.
Roger, the lights show up very well. And thank everybody for turning them on, will you?
Roger, sure will, John.
Roger, we're still go.
Hi, Roger, Friendship 7. All systems are go in the capsule.
Friendship 7, Grimus, if you have a chance, could you give us a blood pressure check? Over.
Hi, Roger, Friendship 7, we'll give blood pressure check. I still have some of these particles that I cannot identify coming around the capsule occasionally. Over.
Roger, how big are these particles? Over.
Very small. I would indicate they're of the order of a 16th of an inch or smaller. They drift by the window, and I can see them against the dark sky. Just at sunrise, there were literally thousands of them. It looked like just a myriad of stars. Over.
Thomas LOS.
LOS. Loss of signal. Weymouth has lost contact, and Friendship 7 streaks home. An unseen comet darting across the land of its origin.
Canaveral contact, how do you copy, over?
Friendship 7 to Canaveral, read you loud and clear, how may, over?
Roger, Friendship 7, Canaveral contact, read you loud and clear, stand by the Capcom, please.
Roger.
Roger, still reading you. 7, this is Cape Coast, Bermuda now.
Roger, this is Friendship 7.
Friendship 7, this is Bermuda Capcom.
Roger, this is Friendship 7. I'm controlling fly-by-wire present time. I have no left jaw, low thrust.
Minor trouble aboard Friendship 7. A malfunction in the automatic control system was causing the spacecraft to yaw in skid-like fashion, away from its proper flight attitude. But Glenn is overriding the faulty system, and now manually controls Friendship 7 on fly-by-wire, directing its movements by hand control, much like a pilot flies a plane.
On fly-by-wire at present time. Understood.
Friendship 7, this is Kano Capcom standing by.
Hello, Kano.
Friendship 7, we have telemetry solid and check all your systems out okay. We'll remind you to start the pre-dark side checklist as soon as you lose contact with us.
Hello, Roger, Friendship 7.
Friendship 7, Friendship 7, this is Mugey Contact. Friendship 7, this is Mugey Contact. Do read, over.
Okay, this is Friendship 7 to me.
Friendship 7, Mugey Capcom. Will you confirm that your landing bag switch is in the off position, over?
That is affirmative. Landing bag switch is in the center off position.
Roger, you haven't had any banging noises or anything of this type at higher rates.
Negative.
Roger, they wanted this answer.
Masked behind that routine report, the first hint of potential disaster. It came when astronaut Cooper relayed a request from Mercury Control, asking Glenn to check the status lights for the capsule's landing impact bag. Glenn reports, status normal. But ground stations are now receiving an ominous chilling signal, an indication that the heat shield on Friendship 7 seems to have come loose.
Friendship 7, Hawaii Contact.
Hawaii, Friendship 7, over.
Friendship 7, this is Hawaii Capcom. Do you still consider yourself go for the next orbit?
Affirmative, I am go for the next orbit.
Roger, understand it. MCC confirms that they are go at the present time for third orbit.
Friendship 7,
Friendship 7, this is California Comtech. California Comtech, do you read? Over.
Hello, California Comtech. Friendship 7, loud and clear. How may?
Roger, Friendship 7, this is California Capcom. Read your line clear, John.
Roger, receiving. You're much better now, Wally. Very good.
John, the AeroMeds are real happy with you. You look real good up there.
All right, fine. Glad everything's working out. I feel real good, Wally. No problems at all.
Good show. We're real pleased to let you goodbye this time. We'll see you next time around.
This is Mercury Control. We now have a contact with our Guaymas, Mexico station and with the Corpus Christi, Texas tracking station. The Friendship 7 spacecraft is now committed to its third orbit. This is Mercury Control.
In Mercury Control at Cape Canaveral, a decision must be made, and soon. The signal pulsing down from Friendship 7 indicates still that the heat shield is loose. Could the signal be erroneous? There is no way to tell. But if it's true, then John Glenn could perish in a searing inferno when he plunges back into the atmosphere. The retro rockets that slow the spacecraft and head it back toward Earth are strapped over the shield. If they were left on after retro fire, instead of being jettisoned as in normal re-entry, then their straps might hold the shield in place before they burn off. They might possibly save Glenn from the 3,000 degrees of re-entry heat until he's deep enough into the atmosphere for its force to hold the shield in place. But the decision must be made soon. Even now, Glenn is streaking toward the United States, and he must begin the retro sequence 300 miles west of California if he's to land in the planned recovery area 700 miles south and east of Florida.
We'll give you the countdown for retro sequence time, John. You're looking good.
Roger. We only have 50 seconds to retrograde. Over.
That's a firm. I'll give you a mark. 45 mark.
California. This is Cape Flight.
Go ahead, Cape Flight.
We'd like to leave the package on at least through Texas. So keep tell him to keep his retro jettison switch off.
John, leave your retro pack on through your pass over Texas.
20 seconds.
Roger.
Manually at this time.
you're going out.
We recommend that you...
Retro pack upon reaching 1 to 1.5 G. Do you understand? Over.
Suddenly, all contact with John Glenn and Friendship 7 is lost.
Over.
This is Friendship 7. I think the pack just let go.
Friendship 7 is escaped. Do you read?
This is Friendship 7. A real fireball outside.
7 is escaped. Transmitting blind.
Okay, Friendship 7, over.
7 is escaped. Do you read, over?
The furnace-like heat of re-entry has created a barrier of ionization around Friendship 7, halting all voice communication. Alone, he plunges back toward Earth, a fiery meteorite.
Okay, Friendship 7, over.
Friendship 7, this is King. Do you read, over?
Okay, Friendship 7, do you receive, over?
The thickening atmosphere breaks his descent, slowing Friendship 7 from 17,500 miles an hour to 1,300 miles an hour in slightly over 3 minutes. And the forces of gravity slam against John Glenn until he weighs 8 times his normal weight. Steelhead is the code name for the destroyer Noah, waiting to recover Friendship 7. But John Glenn cannot hear the message.
Right around 4:43, Clay. It was about on time.
Keep talking, Al.
Friendship 7, this is game. Over. Friendship 7, this is game. How do you read? Over. All right, you're reading loud and clear. How you doing?
My condition is good, but that was a real fireball, boy. I had great chunks of that retro pack breaking off all the way through.
Roger, it did break off, is that correct?
Roger, altimeter off the pack indicating 8,000.
Roger, reading you loud and clear.
Rocking quite a bit, I may still have some of that pack on, I can't damp it either. Going to drogue early. It's a rocky surface. Drogue came out. Drogue is out. Roger, drogue came out at 30,000 in about a 90-degree yaw.
Roger, is the drogue rolling off?
Roger, drogue looks good.
Roger.
Scope did not come out. Roger, pumping the scope out.
Let's go.
Dig in. Roger, re-entry checklist complete. Standing by for May at 10.
Roger.
Coming down on 10, snorkels are open. Roger. Main chute is on green. In race condition at 10,800 feet in. Beautiful shoot. Shoot looks good. On O2 emergency and the shoot looks very good. Rear descent has gone to about 42 feet per second.
The chute looks very good. Hello, Mercury Recovery. This is Friendship 7. Do you receive?
Mercury, Friendship 7, this is Steelhead, loud and clear. Over.
Right here, Steelhead. Friendship 7, the chute looks very good. Over.
Home is the Voyager. Behind, a journey of 81,000 miles. Through 3 days and three nights. In just 4 hours and 56 minutes. At 3:04 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Friendship 7 comes to rest aboard the United States destroyer, NOAA. And John Glenn returns to the people of Earth. A change of clothes, a breath of cool air, a short debriefing. Then, Glenn leaves the NOAA, heading for the aircraft carrier Randolph, under the golden splendor of his fourth sunset of the day. Junior, Lieutenant Colonel, United States Marine Corps. Married, father of two teenage children. Today, John Glenn and the Mercury team challenged space. And they won. Follow tomorrow, and in the tomorrows after that, each step more bold as we reach out to explore the universe around us.